So my present data is actually not about total absence of evidence, but about all nearly total absence of evidence. And I think the main point of it is actually that in some cases I believe that little evidence should be treated as negative evidence, actually when really contextualizing specific sites. So it's about lack of certain types of site around early vital period burial or ritual caves in the Finnish Lake District. And here's some basic information about them. The important thing here is that they are in almost every case located on bedrock promontories on lakeshore at sites where there is or have been before some shore displacement, where very good view to the lake, even if in forested environment, and as we have here. Well, I can't really use this, but as you can see here, and even if there's quite dense forest nowadays, you can still. And there has been some short displacement, but still you can have a good view of the lake. And then an important thing is that in the Finnish Lake District there's also another type of ritual site that have a very close lake connection, so to speak. Unlike in some other areas, in the area of Finland, niin all the prehistoric rock art, as far as we know, consist of rock paintings made by red ochre. We don't have any Bronze Age rock carvings in Finland, which is of course an interesting accent as such, but let's put that aside right now. But in Cairns, more than 90% of the detected rock painting, prehistoric rock painting panels in the area of Finland are located in the Finnish Lake District, the very same area where the early metal period lakeshore caves, the so-called Lapp caves, are also located, as you can see, and especially in the southeastern part of the lake district, a dense concentration of both Lapp caves and Neolithic rock paintings. So the Neolithic dating is mostly based on shore displacement models and only a few finds. But when I have been excavating Lapp caves in the Lake District, I noticed some interesting thing. You know, there's one lake named Lake Louhivesi where I have excavated altogether four Lapp caves, and there's about a dozen distinct Lapp caves sites around that lake, but not a single rock painting. Then there's a neighboring lake located very near it, at about the same size where there's almost total lack of Lapp caves. There's only a single Lapp cave found there in the eastern end of that lake, or actually the western end of that lake. But in the eastern end of the lake, there are two major rock painting sites, and then I got the idea that because there's a connection here, maybe these rock paintings are the reason why the communities that used the neighboring lake, and they must have used that lake too, because there are a lot of early metal period dwelling sites around both lake. Maybe the rock paintings are the reason why they did not build Lapp caves around this lake, but only the other lake. Because one of these rock painting sites is a really major one of the three largest rock paintings. Sites in the area of Finland, and importantly, we know for a fact that even though it seems that the paintings themselves have been made already during the Neolithic period, that they were venerated by the early metal period communities of the area, because at a few sites we have found some hard evidence of early metal period sacrificial activities in front of these rock painting sites here. And you can see there's some Horned anthropomorph, which is one of the most common figures in the Finnish rock painting sites. So I decided to do some additional research, and when I made a very simple distance calculation between the coordinates of the Lapp caves sites and the nearest rock painting site, that and I noticed that really there's very few of the Lapp caves sites are located we are within even 2 kilometers from the nearest rock bedding site, and you know, because the lakes in the Finnish Lake District, they are really concentrations of prehistoric sites. You know, more than 50% of the Lapkeen sites are located between two kilometers of some prehistoric dwelling site, for example. So, but of course, in statistical sense, this of course proves little to nothing for a number of reasons, which I. But you all understand, I guess. Yes, but because there's, as you can see, only five sites that are located within even 2 kilometers from the nearest rock bedding site, we can analyze them really site by site to see if there seems to be some kind of separation between the Lapkeens and rock bending sites. And I think this is one of the most interesting case, the Lehtikko-Konnivesi area, where we have one detected Lapkeen site and as many as three rock bending sites. As you can see here, this Lapkeen, Lapinsaari, is here located in a small island where there has been a lake due to in the direction of north. And all the rock bending sites, they are all located east of that site. And of course, there's water between the Lapkeen site and this cluster of rock bedding site. And also, there are very high bedrock areas here in the neighboring islands. So when people were standing in the Lapkeen site, there would be no due to the rock bedding sites. And if they believe that, you know, the figures in the rock beddings could see the lake. They could not have seen the Lapkeen site or whatever was happening at the site, because the lake views from the rock bedding sites, they are totally different from those from the Lapkeen site. So even if there's distance between the Cairns and Cairns site at the Neolithic rock bedding site, less than 800 meters, they are topography. Practically quite above part, so to speak. I think the physical barriers between them I find it likely that they also were considered as mental barriers by the people who probably used the both of these sites. As you can see here, there's a three plateau of the 5555 cases of Cairns being located within 2 kilometers. You can see, for example, here is quite the same pattern. The lake here on the Lapkeen side is here, and from the rock bedding sites here, and then there's high ground between them in addition to poor water, and in addition to the fact that the lake orientation of them is different. But then there's been somewhat different case here, where that years that there is a rock bedding site and the Lapkeen site in the same cape here, but there's some special features in this site too. One thing, we are not actually entirely sure that this cairn is actually a Lapkeen. It located at the site typical for Lapkeens, but it's pretty small cairn, and therefore and it's still unexcavated, so it could be a number of other things also, but even if we assume that it is a genuine Lapkeen, there actually seems to be a topographic separation between the sites. One rock bedding, Hakavuori B, is one of the few rock bedding sites that are not located on the vertical side of the lakeshore promontory, but in a last glacial era, as you can still not able to use it, but you can see. When we take a closer look at what one could see from the rock painting site or the Lapkeen site, even if we assume that the environment was totally deforested, which is quite an unlikely thing. And you can see one standing here in the rock painting site, which was located very high, about 10 meters higher elevation than the Lapkeen site. But because there's some even higher ground here behind the Lapkeen site, even if we assume that there was no forest, the person standing here by the rock painting could not have seen the cairn really, because of this higher ground here. And this was
Well, yes, because of the high ground people standing here by the hill, they would have had a very good lake view, but the rock painting site would have been totally invisible for them. So here, there was topographic separation between the sites here too. Even those the real case where there appears not to have been any water between the sites. And then another little more complicated things. It's often said that Lapps are often located near contemporary dwelling sites, early Middle period dwelling sites. That in a sense it is true, I think, because they are altogether 22 dwelling sites with early Middle period ceramic finds that are located between 2 kilometers of some Lapps site. But when one takes a closer look to that local topography around the site, it seems that, you know, about 60% of all Lapps have been made in a lake island. In many cases, the island is very small and rocky, less than 2 hectares in size. In some cases, larger, but in any case, it seems that they are frequently surrounded by water, the Lapps site, and of course, something, a thing that easily comes to your mind that is intentional, that they were intended this spiritual world which they were connected in what was separated from this world by water. Because of this a very, very, very common ethno-archaeological notion in Northern Eurasia, as you are probably aware. But then there are three dwelling sites that have been dated to the early metal period, although only one of these has actually been excavated, that appeared to have been located in the same island with Lapps. And so I started to wonder what kind of sites are these really, because they seem to contradict the pattern that I had conjured up. Yeah, but let's take a look about this context. This one is Kitulansuora around the Lake Rohivesi, and there are three Lapps in this former lake island. This is a very large bedrock promontory, high bedrock promontory here, and two of them I have been excavated, and for the fact that they lay to the very beginning of the early bedrock period, to the early Bronze Age, and then there's a dwelling site here where there have been some large-scale excavation in the 90s, and we don't know that the use span of that dwelling site seems to have been more than 2,000 years long, but we know for the fact that it only came to use at the beginning of the early metal period for the simple fact that during the Stone Age it was still under water because of the soil displacement development around this particular lake. But we also know about the fact that these two cases, even though they are located near each other, at this distinct, there seems that they were built almost at the same time, at the very beginning of the use span of this dwelling site here. So it seems possible that somehow this dwelling site was directly related to the Cairns, because you can see the extensive dwelling site areas have been located here around this former island. So I started to wonder, What kind of site this actually is here, because it's excavation in the 1990s, they revealed some very rare finds. For example, there's a primitive iron foundry, and just rye seed, for example, barley seed actually, barley seed, that currently the second oldest AMS dated barley seed in the area of Finland, a very rare find in the early metal period. Tai Lake District at the beginning of early metal period, and also there's this in situ broken plot of very rare coastal type of ceramics, the unique find so far in the Lake District. So I got an idea that it's not actually a settlement here, but some kind of ritual area directly related to the Cairns located in the same island, because then I think it would make perfect sense that we have these dwelling site areas here separated by water from this what I think was probably a sacred island, and then there's area that might not have, that probably was not accessible to all members of the community, and where some rituals were conducted. But of course we do not know that for a fact, but I come to that now, and this is not
Okay, so what is the other
case here is pretty similar. We have several Lappians here, and then we have some early metal period. Find a somewhat unusual site because it's located very much higher than the early metal period dwelling site usually are in this area. And then we have extensive dwelling site areas. See here outside this former lake island.
But then when I was excavating around Lake,
I came across this after excavating two Lapp-Cairns here also early front concept by sun because there was this tree fallen by storm here and then we noticed, well actually one of the members of my excavation, we noticed that there was a lot of burnt bone here in the former beach and here and actually we next year I conducted test excavation for an area of only 6 square meters and we collected some 1 kilogram of burnt bone from that small area. There was a lot of human bone there but also burnt animal bone from elk, for example. And of course, this kind of site, I think no one doubt that this is certainly not a dwelling site, but some kind of ritual site related to this. Here in the same island. And when I got two AMS dating from the human bone finds here, it actually turned out to be late Neolithic, which is very interesting because they proved that this island here was considered a sacred place already before these four Lapp-Cairns were built in them. And also here we have a case that in the same island there appears to have been an activity area here that has left behind remains that sometimes would have been perhaps interpreted as dwelling site remains because there are also some ceramics, sort of early metal period ceramics, or also in addition to a large amount of burnt bone and also quartz flakes and things like that here. And here we have a Neolithic and early metal period dwelling site here that was generated by water from this island originally.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, I think you basically already heard my conclusions. And when you look at these exceptions to the absence of sites, you might see it here when you take into account the site-specific features, they would make perfect sense without contradicting the absence of evidence, without contradicting the significant absence. I'm sorry for the extra time.